John Seeley Brown, John Hagel, the authors of The Power of Pull, new book by Basic Books. John Seeley Brown, what is the power of pull?
Well, the power of pull, if done right, can be tremendous. But the catch is that we have come out of the 20th century, and the 20th century was based on the power of push. What marketing was about, almost all management strategies were about, hierarchical systems were about, planning was about, so on and so forth. The catch is, in a world of today, which is radically different than just 10 years ago, there's so much uncertainty that you can't plan ahead anything like you used to be able to do. And so you really have to now think about, how do I pull together the resources that I need at the moment I need them in order to make unusual things actually happen? In fact, if you look at the subtitle of this book, sometimes it says even more than the title, in terms of how do small moves, smartly made, set big things in motion, which really says that we as individuals can have tremendous influence in the world, as can corporations, as can regions of the world. But all of these things turn on being able to find and pull assets, pull them into action in behalf of some strategic end you want to achieve. So it's a complete reversal of the command-control economy to one that says, no, it's just the opposite. Instead of pushing things into action, how do you pull things naturally into action and make interesting things happen almost seamlessly by leveraging the natural propensity of things around you?
John Hagel, this is a hard one. In 30 seconds, what is pull? Because I like this book a great deal. I found it fascinating, but I'm still struggling to define exactly what pull is, or perhaps sure. Push as well.
Sure. I think that push, to start with, is the notion of a model that says their first job is to predict or forecast demand and then make sure that all the people and resources are in the right place at the right time to meet that demand. That's the essence of a push program, and that's the way businesses have been built for the past century.
So what is it? IBM? It's Microsoft?
IBM, Ford.
You name it.
The automobile manufacturers, the pharmaceutical manufacturers, you name it.
Washington, D.C.
Washington, D.C.
United Nations.
The educational system. All our institutions are basically driven off this notion of anticipating demand and making sure all the resources are there. The proposition around pull is, since forecasting and prediction is more and more challenging, the real power is around creating pull platforms where you can draw out people and resources when you need them and where you need them. You don't try to anticipate, you just make sure that they're accessible, that they can be attracted to you, and that you can drive performance improvement around pull platforms.
So is Google an example of a pull company?
Google would be an example of the first level of pull. So we differentiate three levels of pull. The first level of pull is simply accessing people and resources when you need them, asking a question, getting an answer quickly. That's a very basic level of pull. Second level of pull becomes more interesting. It's the notion of attracting people and resources to you that you weren't even asking for, that you didn't even know existed, but who, when you encounter them, turn out to be extraordinarily valuable and helpful. It's serendipity, basically, is the second level of pull. And then the third level of pull has to do with pulling out of each of us our full potential as individuals and institutions. So it gets to performance improvement and learning, and how do you use those first two levels of pull to accomplish that more effectively.
John Seeley Brown, how did we get from push to pull? Was it a technological revolution, a philosophical revolution, a logistical revolution?
And I would say actually all three of those, maybe even being an epistemological revolution. I mean, the catch is that the push world isn't working very well. And it ain't working very well because things have become so uncertain today, in part because of digital technology. Digital technology, unlike the transportation infrastructures that defined the 20th century, our new digital infrastructure has no S-curve to it. Now we have exponentials, exponentials on exponentials. We have sequences of rapid punctuated evolutions. Okay? So the technological digital age is disrupting the normal ways we used to operate. So on the one hand, that's the cause of this kind of revolution we're entering. The curious thing to us is the very thing that causes the revolution, causes this transformation, if you wish, now provides us fantastic tools to be able to play the game fundamentally differently. So we come into this game thinking like everything that kind of made us successful in the 20th century may actually be obstacles to the 21st century. Now we have to step back and understand how to use the power tools that we're so familiar with. And we'll talk about it later, cloud computing, social network theory, all this, of course, Google type stuff. But how do we actually pull the resources we need? How do we leave behind signals about what we're really interested in so people find us to join, help us do certain things, and so on and so forth? So the command and control economy was an artifact of one type of infrastructure. Now we have a brand new type of infrastructure that kind of obliterates the value of that command and control economy and really blows open brand new ways to work, to organize, to learn, and to live.
And one word answer, what you guys are really saying is blow everything up, right?
No, not at all.
No?
No.
John?
I'd say
one word, yes or no?
Maybe.